In the darkest depths of his heart, John knew that he loved his terrible apartment in Boston's Chinatown neighborhood. He loved waking up in the morning to the sound of trucks backing up directly underneath his window that didn't seem to shut all the way. He loved getting up and brushing his teeth, only noticing after he goes to spit that his water is yellow again. Jonathan loved all these things because, more than life itself, Jonathan loved to bitch. He had 145 followers on Twitter. After selling his guitar to buy his now ex-girlfriend a cat, John was devoid of any real hobbies. He would tell you now that back then, he did his best to remain on a solid diet after he lost his real job and started to work at the store downstairs. He now subsists on rationed boxes of Annie's mac and cheese and club crackers. John is saving up for a house. John is paying his student loans. One day, Jonathan is in the street, not really paying attention to where he's going. He got a perplexing text message at the last second before sending an aggressive response to the one prior, and he reallocated all of his body's processing power to make sure that he did not accidentally send it anyways, which was made not when he was tapped lightly by a truck whose driver was also not looking where he was going. 21 minutes later, a 7-month relationship had ended. John spent the money he saved up for dinner on gin and cigarettes and camped in the living room of his bullshit Chinatown apartment, playing video games for a dog's age. He would have to stop and think for a moment if asked when he last left home. Thursday, he'd remember, though last or prior is anyone's guess. Today was an unremarkable Tuesday in March. The tall building served as a long tunnel where breeze matured into gale at its west end, and at 1:36 p.m., Jonathan stood before a gun. It was resting on a trash bag in a dumpster in the alley beside his house. The gun was a Walther P99, but he had no idea. He stared with longing eyes rivaled only by the most lustful of lovers. He had no need for the protection a gun may bring him, but in the dreadful life and times of our friend Jonathan, this gun was so much more than a weapon. The sleek sidearm was a trinket, burning into him like a cursed ring, demanding it be worn. He decided to ignore the gun and retreated inside for all of 45 seconds when the agony of returning to find it gone was so great that he could no longer bear it. Jonathan sat in his throne, glancing momentarily in the direction of the unusable kitchen table, obscured entirely by mountains of trash, his treasury of garbage. As far as the IRS was concerned, he was nobody, but unbeknown to them, his true fortune lay in empty boxes and dead lighters. The air in the apartment was so thick with smoke as John felt the wind had borrowed enough of his cigarettes this winter. The smell of ash was his queen, and each cigarette was a knight sent to die for the glory of their lord, he thought. John took the gun out of his jacket pocket and inspected it. Is it on? He thought. He held it like one would hold it in a movie, aiming it at the small television across the living room. The electric sensation he got merely holding it elevated him to a new state of being. His surroundings all made sense to him. His kingdom was here all along, and Jonathan was the King of Chinatown.